Hello, everyone. Thank you all so much for taking the time today to join us for our latest installment of the Meeting of the Minds webinar series. I know I am so thrilled to see so many familiar faces and names in the Zoom room. And for those of you who might be joining us for the first time, we're definitely delighted to have you here too. This webinar series is just one of the many programmatic offerings from NCWIT's higher ed team, in addition to our systemic change initiatives like our learning circles. And of course, you'll be hearing about that from us soon. But today's Meeting of the Mind session is really an opportunity for us to highlight CAHSI as one of our BPC Alliance partners. And actually, all of today's panelists represent institutions that are Higher Ed Alliance members. And many of those institutions have actually participated in our systemic change programs. So we're really excited for today's session to continue to build that cross-alliance synergy across BPC Accelerator Alliances. And of course, for those who are familiar with this work, Dr. Ann Kiros-Gates needs no introduction. She's played an integral role in the BPC world throughout her career. She currently serves as the senior advisor to the provost on strategic STEM initiatives at the University of Texas at El Paso. She's also a founding member and lead of CAHSI, which is a nationally recognized network of more than 60 colleges, universities, and stakeholders that focus on the recruitment, retention, mentorship, and advancement of Hispanics in computing. CAHSI is one of six national alliances funded by the NSF and the Includes program, which is a comprehensive initiative to develop STEM talent from all sectors and groups in our society. And thank you so much for being here today. And thank you to the wonderful panel that you've gathered here for us. And just before I turn it over to you, I just want to mention that my colleague, Chris Hovey, will be monitoring the chat for questions. So for those of you who are excited to engage with our panelists, which I hope is all of you here today, please direct your questions to him and he'll be sharing that with our panelists at the end of our session. So without further ado, Anne, thank you so much.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the kind introduction, and thank you to NCWIT for inviting us to present at the first session of Meeting the Minds. So let me start by giving you a brief introduction of CAHSI. Since CAHSI's inception in 2006, with funding from the NSF, Broadening Participation in Computing Program, and with funding from the NSF Includes Program in 2018, CAHSI grew from seven Hispanic-serving institutions to over almost 80 institutions, 52 four-year colleges, 28 two-year colleges. In 2021, spurred by funding from the NSF size Broadening Participation in Computing Alliance Program, nine new R1 HSIs joined CAHSI's collective efforts to focus on increasing the number of Hispanics entering and completing graduate programs. CAHSI is a national alliance of Hispanic-serving institutions and private and public sector partners. Our focus is on collectively advancing and empowering Hispanics in computing, accelerating inclusive educational cultures, and shaping future leaders. We operate by serving as a catalyst for research and institutional capacity building through its work on advocacy, promotion on data and knowledge-informed decision-making, its mutually reinforcing activities across collaborative networks, and adoption of research and evidence-based practices across its members. Key pieces of the CAHSI infrastructures are the CAHSI connectors and coordinators, shown in green, who are staff members supporting each of the four CAHSI regional leads and serving as a bridge between CAHSI backbone and its members and institutions in their respective regions. You can see the four regions served by CAHSI on the map, which includes those states that have the largest populations of Hispanic. That's the West, which serves California. The Southwest is Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. The Southeast is Florida and Puerto Rico. And the North serves Illinois, New Jersey, Connecticut, Virginia, and New York. Our vision is by 2013, Hispanics will represent 20% or more of those who earn credentials in computing. And our mission is to grow as a network community committed to accelerating progress of Hispanics in computing. Our goals are to challenge students' knowledge, skills, and ability, that to position them to be competitive in the workforce, to support professional growth of those who serve Hispanics, and that is faculty and staff, expand meaningful partnerships, and inform policy through evidence. Today, we will have four speakers that will be giving you an overview of CAHSI. Dr. Jessica Rivera will set the stage by speaking on the research regarding what it means to serve Hispanics. Next, we'll hear from Dr. Nida Santiago on CAHSI's efforts on empowering the next generation of students, and Dr. Patricia Morreale will speak on CAHSI's effective practices for building departmental and student capacity and preparing our students for success in the major and competitive computing positions. And then Dr. Enrico Pontelli will then describe our work on systemic change, the role of administrators for moving from practice to institutionalization and also partnerships. So I will now hand it over to Dr. Rivera.
Hi, everyone. So happy to be here. Like Dr. Gates shared, my name is Jessica Rivera, and I'm currently a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Texas in San Antonio. I had the privilege of working with CAHSI since 2019, and it's been a really great experience and kind of getting connected with an organization that's making meaningful change with intentionality to serve students at Hispanic-serving institutions. And so to kind of provide a context on Hispanic serving institutions, because I think it's very important to talk about what type of students are at our institutions. Students at HSIs have to enroll at least 25% Hispanic or Latina undergraduate students and 50% low-income students in order to receive a designation as HSIs. This is a growing group of institutions. We have about 571 HSIs, which make up about one-fifth of the higher education students in the higher education institutions in the United States. And those institutions serve 62% of all Hispanic students in higher education. So a big majority of the Hispanic students that are in higher education are in this small group of institutions. And HSIs are not just serving Hispanic students, as you'll learn some of the faculty on this panel, work in highly diverse HSIs. And so we serve large numbers of Black students, Native American students, also high numbers of first generation college students and low income students. And typically Hispanic serving institutions often receive less federal funds to support these students, even though they might have higher needs. But these institutions actually do a lot more with the funds that they receive to really support student success. And so I'm going to talk about this topic of Hispanic servingness. It's a pretty recent topic. It was in 2019, Gina Garcia, Anne Marie Nunez, my mentor and advisor when I was in my PhD program, and Vanessa Sansone came up with this term of Hispanic servingness. And so a few years back, Hispanic serving institutions really got critiqued for the servingness in their title. You know, they're Hispanic serving institutions, but to what extent are they actually serving the students at their institution? Was a question. Looking at mission statements of institutions, people really questioned what is, you know, what's the intentionality behind actually serving the students that are involved in your institution. And so I believe that CAHSI actually enacts a lot of servingness in their practices. With Anne Marie Nunez, I had the opportunity to conduct research at four CAHSI institutions and really try to examine to what extent is CAHSI really addressing, you know, the needs of students at their institutions, promoting success in a discipline that is really lacking diversity. Actually, in the last decade, there's been a decline in diversity, even though there's been some growing numbers, maybe at the undergraduate level in computing. Some numbers at the PhD level show a decline. So this is really an area, a discipline within STEM that really needs concerted efforts to diversify, and CAHSI is actually doing that. So I was able to interview along with Anne Marie Nunez. She was the PI on the study, and we interviewed over 100 faculty, staff, students, administrators at these four CAHSI institutions to really try to understand from an organizational level, how are all these pieces working together to really serve, truly serve Hispanic students. And so Hispanic serving institutions play a key role is one kind of big takeaway, but how is that actually happening? So CAHSI is actually developing practices, changing policies to promote the success of Hispanic students. And that's done throughout various different ways. And I'm gonna highlight two of the articles that are posted in this slide. So one of them was written by Anne-Marie Nunez, and then the other one was in collaboration with me on looking at staff. And so we realized that faculty and staff play an enormous role in really contributing to student success. And so intentionality is really the key when deciding when to prioritize efforts. And an example of what CAHSI does is looking at the data, right? CAHSI makes data-informed decisions, examining where really efforts need to be concerted. And so I'm just gonna highlight my colleague Sangha Kim, who works with CAHSI as a data, the data expert. And so she's created a data dashboard on the CAHSI website, and that has a lot of the key data that CAHSI is looking at to really examine where should we concert our efforts. And this is done at an institutional level, not broadly. Context is really important. So a practice that might work at one HSI, CAHSI institution might not work at another. And so faculty and staff are very intentional in looking at the numbers, where are the areas that we really need to focus our efforts. The department personnel play a very key role. Faculty and staff, I got to meet amazing faculty and staff that are really promoting student success. And it's not just about adding programming or making a few changes here and there. It's also about changing faculty mindsets. So instead of focusing on how students might not be prepared, faculty are very strategic in implementing programs that can best support student success. So they're setting up students for success. Their mindsets are to serve, right? This is the servingness piece, right? I interviewed a faculty member that said, you know, just like doctors take a medical oath to provide the best care for their patients, I take an academic oath as a faculty member to make sure that I'm promoting the success of my students. They're also very intentional in the staff that they hire. One faculty member was very strategic in hiring someone with a social science background that could understand some of the barriers and challenges that students were going through as they were navigating computer science. So this lens, this awareness, identifying the importance of that was really important in helping students succeed. I'm gonna highlight a little bit more about this staff because that's where I focus most of my efforts. And so staff were incredibly encouraging and supportive of students. They engaged students in leadership opportunities. I interviewed students that said, you know, I never saw myself as a leader, but this staff person really encouraged me to see myself as a leader and encouraged me to take advantage of opportunities in the department. And now these students are doing amazing things out in the world. Navigating student institutional processes was very important as well. Like I said earlier, a lot of students at HSIs are typically first generation college students. And so navigating the institution and the hidden curriculum is key. And so a lot of the staff that were working at CAHSI institutions were aware of students' backgrounds, were intentional in providing them with the support to be able to navigate the resources, right? Institutions have resources for students to take advantage of, but if students don't know how to access them, how can that really help them achieve success? And students at one institution, a student actually referred to one of the staff persons as the CS mom, right? This person that was the go-to that was helping them navigate the institution. Another key thing that CAHSI is really intentional is being forward thinking, right? What are students gonna be doing after they graduate? How can we support them by providing them with information on how to navigate career opportunities? And so staff were aware of how students were busy, right? Currently we're doing a study looking at students who are caregivers. And so there's students have a lot of responsibilities on their plates at HSIs. And so sometimes this prevents them from accessing opportunities, but staff were very aware of this. They also were in tune that students might feel unqualified or not ready for these opportunities. So some staff would say, okay, you're coming to my office, we're gonna sit down and we're gonna work on these applications together. So they're very intentional in providing students with support. And then in higher...
Closing.
Oh, yes. So staff were really intentional in promoting the success of students. I'm just going to go over one future thing that CAHSI is kind of looking forward to, is really diversifying graduate education at HSIs. And CAHSI is doing that right now through the Doctoral Scholars Network, which is providing a space for minoritized students at HSIs that are in computer science.
And thank you so much, Jessica. There's so much to say here, I know. We're going to now turn it over to Nida, who's a CAHSI lead for the Southeast region, and she'll talk a little bit more of some of the models for serving students.
Hello. My name is Nida Santiago, and I am very pleased to be here. I'm going to describe the role of advocates, scholars, analysts, and industry in empowering the new generation of Hispanic leaders in computing. Let's start with the advocates. This is a program that the CAHSI Student Advocates empowers student leaders to champion students' success by actively promoting CAHSI practices and activities. Through this initiative, a vital network of leaders is cultivated, fostering a community building and collaboration across institutions. The student advocates play a pivotal role as connectors with their respective institutions. In my case, my advocate Jimmy promotes all the different activities in my institution that come from CAHSI, from the backbone and other institutions. The advocates engage in face-to-face interactions, disseminate information about opportunities through social media, email, and other means. They even use WhatsApp chats, or they use different types of technologies to promote information dissemination, and provide workshop support, foster collaborations among student organizations, several student organizations related to computing. They engage them in promoting each other opportunities and working with them. Implementing also student engagement strategies, they facilitate professional development, and they promote on-campus corporate recruitment efforts. They sometimes are contacted by industry to promote different activities and help them in disseminating these activities. At the regional level, the CAHSI backbone supports the advocates, and they guide and advise the advocates as a collective. Nationally, the advocates collaborate to explore innovative ways in which how to connect the student community and share those best practices and learn from one another. The professional development of advocates is done through a session that is done at the Great Minds in STEM Conference. They also have bi-weekly media calls and soft skill development to team projects, and they serve as student role models. So they are the new pioneers for community building. Then the second activity that we have is the student scholars. The student scholars program celebrates those students who excel in professional development, scholarly pursuit, community outreach, and co-curricular activities. They embody CAHSI's mission and values. By showcasing the diverse talents within the CAHSI institution, this program creates the new CAHSI leaders that will be the ones that would carry CAHSI over to the next to the future. They provide opportunities to advance Hispanic student success. And we celebrate these scholars at the Great Minds in STEM Conference. As I mentioned, these are going to be the new CAHSI generation of leaders. Allyship is another effort in which this effort was funded by remote representation. And it aims to foster the success of female and all students in computing field throughout a structured mentorship program. Undergraduate core students who are in fundamental courses are paired with peers who have completed data structure courses in their institution, forming allies and proteges. These pairs engage in monthly professional development activities led by a faculty member and also by staff, and promote connections and learning experiences throughout the academic year. Participants benefit from a different set of advantages, including access to resources, share experiences, network opportunities with peers, and they also receive a modest stipend. The primary focus of this program is supporting women of color and non-binary students. However, it welcomes all students that promote inclusion and excellence. This pilot initiative is open to undergraduate students in the University of Texas, El Paso, and University of Puerto Rico, and Mayagüez. However, we are planning to expand into New Mexico State University and also Kean University. Finally, our industry partners not only provide funding from CAHSI initiatives and efforts, they also share experiences that build the students' identity as computer scientists, and they also provide experiences of their career path. For example, there is a session in Latinas in Computing at the Grace Mainstream Conference, and we coordinate the industry partners to provide career advice to students. So in a setting that they feel very comfortable speaking to industry members. So these CAHSI signature practices are empowering the next generation of Hispanic. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next, we're gonna turn it over to Pat Morreale. She leads the North region and she's gonna talk about practices focused on building departmental and student capacity building. Pat?
Yes, thank you, Anne, appreciate it. Thank you all for coming this afternoon. It's really terrific to have this opportunity to talk to you about all the terrific practices that we have at CAHSI. So CAHSI is particularly effective, I think, in having a local understanding of problems, which vary from campus to campus. As Anne said at the beginning, CAHSI is now over 80 colleges and universities, both two-year and four-year programs, with a strong network of interconnected people, programs, and practices. And I mentioned people first because that is really what CAHSI focuses on. It's a hallmark of CAHSI to work with faculty, work with students, understand the problem, develop a solution, revise it, try it again. All of our campuses in CAHSI have different contexts, and hopefully some of these practices are useful to you on your campus. So the first one I'd like to talk about is building connections to the students. CAHSI problem-solving materials, for example, were developed because we realized that students coming into the first course in computer science frequently were interested in computer science, but maybe didn't have the basic problem-solving skills that they needed to be successful, reading a problem, figuring out what was being asked, breaking it down. So CAHSI faculty worked collaboratively to develop a series of courses that would help students understand problem-solving techniques and use them to analyze computer science problems. Now, some schools teach this as a standalone course. Other schools have integrated it into the first and second computer science courses. Either way, our students are benefiting. We know this because employers are telling us now that during interviews, students are able to narrate why they picked the solution they did, how they solved the problem, and the outcomes and trade-offs of the other problem. So the problem-solving instruction that our students are receiving early on is paying benefits all the way through their four-year degree. Peer-led team learning is another CAHSI signature practice that has been widely disseminated. It started again by realizing students liked hearing from peers what worked. They liked having peers they could speak to about courses and curriculums. And often, as we all know, peers are more effective in getting those messages across than faculty are. CAHSI worked to educate the peers and let them know what they could share with the students and how they could be appropriate in working with their students, making sure that the curriculum was well supported through their resources. This has led at some institutions to a new student orientation just for computer science, computing majors. This has been very effective in bringing the new students in, introducing them to their peer-led team as they are beginning their career, and making sure the students are comfortable, they have a cohort community, and they know how to contact the people that can help them be successful during their university career. Moving up then in the years, we want to make sure we engage students in undergraduate research. This should be familiar to those of you that are knowledgeable about NCWIT's REU in a box, because that includes the CAHSI Affinity Research Group model. First piloted in 2008 through the cooperative framework, we have built on it since then, making sure that faculty receive appropriate mentor training so that they can work one-on-one or in small groups with undergraduate research students, bringing them through the definition of the problem, forming of hypotheses, complex questions, receiving feedback, positive constructive feedback, and helping our students then present their research posters. The ARG model is particularly useful in bringing in novice students, having them mentored usually by students that have been through the research model, a little bit more senior. Again, the peer model comes into effect and make sure that those students are then able to present their research at a conference if they choose. This was again first piloted with an article in 2008. It has matured. We used it heavily during COVID. We want to make sure one of the ways that we share the affinity research group model is through faculty mentoring, which we now have with a pilot course on Canvas. We're sharing it with other disciplines as well outside of computing. So student experiences are particularly important that they get shared within our departments. We need to make sure that a lot of the implicit mentoring that we give to our students is shared from one generation of students to the next. Internships, REUs, what steps need to be taken? And CAHSI provides a framework for sharing this information to our students. Several years ago, we realized that students without resources might not be able to leave campus for a summer and go take a traditional research experience at an undergraduate institution. They couldn't just pick up and go to the East Coast or the West Coast for 8 or 10 weeks, leaving family, the part-time job, things like that. Collaboratively working together, we developed a solution. First, it was called the virtual REU, hallmarks of COVID there, which has since become the local REU, where students are partnered, staying at their local space or in their current context, and they may get a mentor that is down the hall, or they could get someone cross-country. This matching has been very effective. We've been able to reach students in much greater numbers than we did before. This year is one of our biggest years. I think we're reaching about 169 students this year, which is up from far more modest beginnings, believe me. And these students are getting exposed to research, and as a result, their appetite for education and additional graduate training is increasing. Whether they continue for a graduate degree immediately or they go later, that's fine. They know they can do it. And that self-worth and self-efficacy has been shared with them through the CAHSI techniques. And all of this comes back then to faculty. It's not just students. As faculty, we communicate our expectations to our students. We do this through, in some cases, growth mindset, letting our students know that they can go on for graduate education. We have some techniques where we have used growth mindset language, putting phrases on labs. You can do it. You can try. Keep it up. Very good. Encouraging our students to practice, which is so important in computer science, from the problem solving that we share with them initially all the way up through graduation, we are coaching and encouraging them. And these techniques are really being codified by CAHSI. Some of the practices are on the CAHSI website. Again, they have been refined and changed over time to make sure that they would work for you in your context if you're interested in working with them. We heard from Jessica earlier about how CAHSI has grown and the diversity of the schools. Many schools in CAHSI are majority minority, meaning quite a few Hispanic students. Other schools in the CAHSI community do not have as many Hispanic students. There's a mix of different student populations. These practices, as was pointed out earlier, work very well with all of these communities of students, from meeting the students initially, shepherding them through an undergraduate research experience, creating an appetite and an interest, whether it's in research or a professional career. A career education course has been piloted at several of our institutions, teaching students how to interview, how to acquire the professional job, how to go through the series of interviews. A lot of my students are very surprised that there could be 6 or even 7 series of interviews for some of the top tier companies. But we coach them through this as we communicate our expectations to the students. All this works together and allows us to share our best practices among ourselves and through the ecosystem that is CAHSI community.
Well, thank you so much, Pat. I appreciate that. We're going to now transition to Dean Pontelli, who will talk about engaging administrators and partners.
Thank you very much. I'm Enrico Pontelli, New Mexico State University. Very early on, CAHSI realized also the importance of engaging institutional leaders in the activities of CAHSI. And this became even more prominent and obvious when CAHSI transitioned to become an Includes Alliance. So institutional leaders really play a very important role in driving change, create accountability, and become champions of the practices. As in all the practices that Pat described, that Naida described, they're very really driven by faculty, but how to elevate those from localized faculty efforts to institutional change really requires the engagement of institutional leaders. And this should not be surprising because we're talking about addressing systemic inequities in order to actually implement changes. Doing systemic inequities requires systemic changes. And institutional leaders are very well positioned to actually achieve these systemic changes because institutional leaders, first of all, understand the historical context that exists within the institution, and they understand the institutional barriers, the policies, the practices, the habits, and the culture that really can either facilitate or obstaculate systemic changes. So really, institutional leaders are agents of change that enable moving from localized interventions, localized practices, to organizational transformation, which is really what we want to ultimately achieve. And there are many ways in which, within CAHSI, institutional leaders have assisted in these changes by, for example, aligning bureaucracy to this evidence-based practices, establishing accountability by implementing changes to evaluations, tenure, and promotion policies, by setting high expectation, rewarding risk-taking. And, you know, one of the things that, at least personally, I always found very frustrating is the fact that in traditional computer science departments, BPC is not seen as real scholarship, which is really something that is completely wrong. It is real scholarship. It's probably even more impactful than kind of the traditional scholarship that we see. So really, institutional leaders are instrumental in building trust and comfort for faculty who want to engage and explore BPC and elevating these changes into institutional changes. And I'm very happy to see, for example, what happened in my own institution where Hispanic servingness, which kind of Jessica talked at the beginning of the presentation, is now part of our own institution strategic plan. So we see that shift of culture. And that shift of culture is very, very important. I really want our faculty to talk about cultivating the students that they have, not the students that they wish they had. So leaders can really set the tone, serve themselves as role model. CAHSI has also been very good because many of the leaders of CAHSI are themselves institutional leaders. We have department chairs who are involved, we have deans who are involved, we have senior administrators who are involved in the activities of CAHSI. Now, this is not easy by any means. And one of the frustrations that we can see when we engage institutional leaders is the fact that, unfortunately, institutional leaders very often have a very short lifespan. They tend to transition very often, which actually becomes itself an obstacle in creating this continuous change. Now, the impact of CAHSI has been extensive. For example, in this slide, you can see a reference to a recent article that has been written by Engates and Faye Cobb-Payton, which really analyzed the challenges of and the opportunities of engaging institutional leader in driving permanent change. We have seen leaders at the table in many of the CAHSI activities. As I was mentioning before, CAHSI regularly brings department chairs at the table, for example, as part of the annual summit. CAHSI has been present in many of the activities of HSRU, which is this coalition of presidents and chancellor of Hispanic serving institution, who have achieved the R1 status. And CAHSI and HSRU, they really share the same objective, which is trying to build capacity by advancing Hispanic faculty and Hispanic graduate students. So we share this common objective. And CAHSI has been invited to present to the convening of HSRU. And another activity that is actually going to come up very soon, we are going to organize a meeting of all the deans of CAHSI institutions at the next Snowbird meeting organized by CRA. So again, that's going to be an opportunity on one hand to educate the deans who are not aware yet of the activities of CAHSI, as well as to actually seek a permanent commitment from these deans to continue supporting the institutionalization of these evidence-based practices. Now, faculty are the leaders of change. They are the ones that design and discover practices. Institutional leaders are the ones that are going to enable this transformation to elevate to the institution. But on the other hand, CAHSI doesn't want to stop at the level of the single institution. They want to actually change communities, change collection of institutions. And this is not possible without partners that actually spans the entire nation. So CAHSI has been fortunate to actually being able to work with amazing organizations like industry. Google and Microsoft has been amazing partners and friends of the activity of CAHSI. Google, for example, has partnered with CAHSI in many activities focused on both building student capacity as well as building research capacity. Two examples, one was already mentioned, the creation of the problem-solving curriculum. That has really been possible thanks to the collaboration with Google, as well as Google has enabled this institutional research program, which is really meant to build research capacity by creating partnership between doctoral serving institution and non-doctoral serving institution within CAHSI. Microsoft is assisting CAHSI in organizing an HSI convening focused on artificial intelligence, which is going to be coming up in the next month. Many nonprofit organizations have partnered with CAHSI. Great Minds in STEM has been a friend of CAHSI for many years. And in fact, the annual CAHSI convening, the annual CAHSI summit, is organized, co-located with the Great Minds in STEM conference every year. And we share conferences, we share sessions. For example, CAHSI has been organizing the hackathons at Great Minds in STEM, as well as the challenges in data analytics. And of course, we cannot forget the fact that we are one of the many BPC alliances, and we work together with the other BPC alliances by sharing evidence-based practices and learning from the other alliances about other practices that have been developed in other contexts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Enrico. I'm going to give some closing remarks, and I would like to just invite everyone to visit our website, and I'm going to highlight a few things that we are doing, the resources that we are providing to the nation and to others, and regarding diversifying computing the workforce in academia. And so we already talked about the literature on Hispanics. We had a nice review by Jessica. Please visit our library on our website, and you can learn more about and read about the articles that were mentioned. We also have a recent article that Jessica was a lead on, looking at graduate pathways for our students who diversify the doctoral programs across the country. In collaboration with QEM, CAHSI published an article, a briefing on the models for sustainability. And there's a variety of models that are provided that may be of interest to you. Over the last 5 years, we have held and organized multiple convenings. One was already mentioned before about the two-day workshop that brought together Hispanic researchers and researchers from HSIs to make recommendations on how to increase the representation of Hispanic and HSIs in the NSFSI's directorate portfolio. The recommendations from this convening, as well as convenings with HBCUs and TCUs, informed the NSF MSI research expansion program. In 2022, CAHSI, in collaboration with four other national alliances, led the 2023 NSF Includes Community convening that brought together and engaged leaders from the NSF Includes Alliance cohorts. And we had deep conversations regarding how best to leverage their collective knowledge, our collective knowledge, the lessons learned, and specific activities to accelerate change in broadening STEM participation. The recommendations from this convening inform the restructuring of the Includes Coordination Hub. Next month, as Enrico mentioned, we will be hosting a convening funded by Microsoft that will bring together Hispanic researchers and other researchers from HSIs on how to strengthen AI research and the involvement of HSI researchers and students. And then how do we involve underserved communities to address local and regional challenges using AI? Next month, CAHSI, in collaboration with the Includes Coordination Hub, will lead a discussion on the importance of using an intersectionality lens in broadening participation. This is a recommendation that came out of CIAS. We've already discussed some of the capacity building efforts we've had with ASEE, Google, Microsoft, and Visa. And CAHSI has created collaborative learning communities with online courses to support adoption of effective practices, as Pat mentioned. We've also established a doctoral scholars network for doctoral students from underrepresented populations, and they meet regularly to discuss, you know, personal, professional, social aspects of retaining. And this particular network was started by Dr. Jessica Rivera and is continued with Dr. Darian. So CAHSI has endorsed several acts for the U.S. House of Representatives Committees on Science, Space, and Technology that was led by Eddie Bernice Johnson in 2021 and 2022. This includes the MSI STEM Achievement Act, Combating Sexual Harassment in Science Act, and then others. And we have debriefed the White House Office of Science Technology Policy regarding CAHSI's signature practices and recommendations on topics that they presented to us. COI, Pat Morreale, serves on the New Jersey Department of Education CS Advisory Committee, the K-12 CS Policy Development that works with the New Jersey Governor's Office and the New Jersey Department of Education to review and revise computer science K-12 policy recommendations and standards. This past month, CAHSI leadership reviewed a bill on AI R&D capacity building for MSIs, HBCUs, and TCUs at the request of a subcommittee of the U.S. House of Representatives Committee on Science, Space and Technology. This bill will authorize and extend the EXPAND AI program. So I hope that our debrief gives you an idea of the work that we're doing. We really encourage you to reach out to us if you have interest in any of the work we are doing. And we really thank you for your attention this afternoon and listening to our presentation.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your presentation. I hope everyone found it as interesting as I did. If you have any questions or comments for our presenters, please put them in the chat and I will happily voice them on your behalf. We're going to start with a question from Katie Gittleman, which is about the career education course and how does that fall under a CS curriculum or how do different universities implement that?
Pat, did you want to answer?
Sure, I'll be happy to. So our curriculum's pretty busy. So we reference the course a lot in our formal curriculum, but we offer it right now as a computer science one credit elective. I don't know what some of the other CAHSI, I see a few nodding heads, but that's been really effective. If you give them an hour a week to talk about how they're going to find that job after graduation, you get some strong brain power. And it's another great way to bring in mock interviews, alumni, all sorts of other role models and peer mentors.
Yeah, and I could collaborate. And I think this is what Pat and both Nida said is that, you know, there's different contexts across our institutions. So some can put it into a one credit hour course, but then others, if we talk about problem solving, let's say, that turned into coding clubs across different CAHSI institutions. And that was encouraged actually by a Googler in residence that said, you know, let's just create this as a co-curricular activity. And that just blossomed. So so there's just various ways that people have picked up the curriculum that was developed.
And as a follow-up question, when in the curriculum is this offered? Is this typically a more advanced courses or is this intro?
Well, if we talk about problem solving, what we did is that we created three courses. The first one credit hour course is for students that are entering into a computer science program. So it has, there's no computing. It's really around problem solving, and it uses the IDEAL framework and focuses on the students asking probing questions to understand the problem more deeply, and then to begin to scope it and identify who needs to be at the table to solve the problem. The second course is on computational thinking. It's usually given students in the CS2 would take that course. Again, it's not heavy into data structures at all. It's just a one credit hour course. The two credit hour course is really more of using data structures and solving the problems using computation. And so this is where having coding clubs have been really effective. And it started out like the current one at UTEP is led by a sophomore, but we have graduate students that come because they really want to be able to learn these skills of how do you think on your feet, but more than that, how do you talk through the process of solving a problem? So there's a lot of modeling, coaching that is done in these courses.
And if somebody was interested in adopting those materials into their own courses, where would they find resources on this?
So we're in the process of moving the problem solving courses onto Canvas, and we expect that to be completed by the summer. And so what we're asking people that are non-CAHSI institutions, they would register, they would agree to give credit to CAHSI for what they're learning. We're also providing certificates of completion if someone wants to show that they went through the course. So it's online. It will be a little bit hybrid. There will be some interaction with the folks that are actually can talk about how the course is delivered. I will say that it's not a lecture course. There's a lot of work on observing and providing feedback. We do have an article in FIE from some years back that really sets the framework of how it's developed. So very little lecturing, a lot of giving students problems, giving observation and feedback on how they're using the model.
Wonderful. And then to dovetail with a question that just got posted, how would someone find out if their institution is a member of CAHSI or not?
On our website, you can go to network, and under network, you will see the CAHSI institutions, and you'll see the ones by region. You'll also know who the regional leads are and the coordinators that can connect you if you do have interest in joining CAHSI.
Wonderful, thank you. So this next question is from NCWIT's own Wendy DeBoe, which is about data. What proportion of Latin computing students at your member institutions do you tend to be able to reach with the opportunities that you provide? And do you have tips for successful outreach to students?
I don't know who wants to answer that. Maybe Nida, because this is why we started the Advocates program. The Advocates, the LRU, has really increased in great engagement mm-hmm. tremendously, and the allyship program, Nida, I'll take
correct.
It.
Correct. Originally, when we started the allyship program, it was like an experiment on how we could find mentors, how we can create collaborations between allies and proteges. And they were hesitant to participate. However, as they started seeing that these activities were really useful, some of the girls started pulling other girls from the group. So they started growing this community. And now I have around maybe 30 girls in our group, and they keep growing and they keep asking me to participate next time because they by word of mouth, they started learning that this is valuable. They are learning something and they are starting to do something. Similarly, in other activities such as art, we started with a very small group, and then by word of mouth, they started growing because they know it works, they know it's useful, and they don't do it necessarily for the money. They do it because they find other people who can mentor themselves. So I believe that there is a tremendous growth in opportunities, and that's why we are expanding now to NMSU and Kean University.
So Google and Reboot Representation are providing the stipends for these programs, and especially Advocates. Advocates was really a way for to have someone engage within a department to increase number one, awareness of CAHSI, but also of the opportunities. Rosa Alpado and a graduate student, we decided to bring graduate students so that they could help with each of the regions. But we provide a lot of training around growth mindset, sense of belonging. One thing that's really impressive, and I'm going to put Pat on the spot here, is that when I visited Kean University, their advocate is actually next door to her office. And there's a lot of programming. So Pat, you might want to talk about how that changed engagement of students.
Well, I think we're not as substantial a shop as many of your other schools, but we do have 800 and something majors at this point. We've grown a lot working with CAHSI and using some of those practices I talked about. What works very much so, I see Enrico put a comment in here about advocates and peer leaders being very effective. It's the personal ask, really, a professor or any mentor or someone who knows them saying, hey, I think this would be good for you. Have you tried it? And then Anita mentioning how they organically grow. You get a few in a room and the next thing you know, it's two times a few and it starts to increase. So that's really positive. So,
and we also started application parties because students are really reticent about applying for programs and opportunities. So that also started to bring more students in within the department.
And I can mention that there is one of the advocates here, and if you want, he can comment about his activities.
Yeah, go ahead.
Jimmy, are you there?
Hi. Yes, I am here. Hi there. My name is Jimmy Carreo. Sorry about that. Thought I closed that door. I'm a CAHSI advocate here at UPRM, the University of Puerto Rico at Mayagüez, and I can only back up what all of you have already said. The advocacy program really encourages these students that would otherwise not come forward to come forward, because the way I've been able to interact with it is students that only had a very abstract goal, as I just want an internship, suddenly go from an abstraction to an actual way of getting there, because the advocate's job is to inform those students like, hey, you want to get to that point? Well, here are the things you can do to get that point. Let's start with your resume. Let's go with your interviews. Now we can apply. And I can second that part with Ann and Pat just said with is the application. That's honestly the hardest part. I am constantly spamming opportunities, internships, REUs, but the hardest part is getting those students to actually apply that and getting them to be comfortable and confident enough to push through that application process.
That's great, Jimmy. Thank you for sharing.
And that's going to dovetail into another question that I have, which is in practical terms, if someone wants to get involved, what would be their first step?
Well, the first step is to contact one of the leads or contact the backbone. And so there's different ways to be involved, right? So if you're a single investigator, we have a mechanism. You're not part of an institution, but you really are focused on our vision and mission. Then we can involve you. We have monthly meetings across the regions. And this is where we share information and we learn challenges or effective practices that are going on across the region. So if you're in HSI, identify the region that you're at and then contact Pat Mosin-Beheshti. I'm not sure if he's on right now, but Nida, he's from the West, Nida Santiago, and then Enrico are the leads. And then the backbone, of course, can help you connect. And so there's different ways to connect. If your industry partners, we will work with you. Again, it's collective impact. It's around mutually reinforcing activities. So identifying those ways that we help each other, because change is not going to happen unless we are all working. Thank you for that question.
Absolutely. And that dovetails into another question, which is, let's say if I'm a faculty member in my department, do you have any tips and pro tips for addressing my administrators to convince them that this is important and to help them prioritize this?
Yes, we just came back for our all hands meeting. And one of our, I won't say the institution, but it's an R1 institution in the West. The faculty member came up to us because she's the representative. And she said, I really want our administrators to pay more, you know, to put this into the strategic plan. Because we will generate broadening participation plans based. So each of the institutions are coming out with their strategic actions that are documented in a tool that we have that can generate a BPC plan. But we know that's CAHSI's actions, right? She wanted to know how can we integrate that now into their own strategic plan. So what we're working on now is developing those one pagers that will give the highlights of why join CAHSI, why be involved. But then the work that Enrico talked about with the presidents and chancellors and deans is work funded by the Sloan Foundation for us to share data through our data dashboard with the deans so that they become the advocates for the departments that report to them. And then the same with the presidents and chancellors. Anne-Marie Nunez is leading that effort through the HSRU. So we are working toward getting there. As Enrico mentioned, our first meeting will be this summer. And then we will continue to begin messaging to the deans and chairs. So thank you.
Wonderful. And to plug another opportunity that NCWIT is also offering, we are engaging in learning circles, and we're accepting people for this upcoming next year's cohort. If you are interested in some NCWIT program and exploring our technical tool, the Tech Inclusion Journey for undergraduate programs, feel free to email any one of our research scientists and we can be in touch about that. Well, so we only have one more minute, so I'm going to turn it back over to Sariu, but thank you all.
Yes. Thank you all so much. This was such a fantastic panel. So I hope you'll join me in applauding with your reaction buttons or thanking the panel in the chat. I do want to make sure before you hop off that you have a chance to access our evaluation form. Our Higher Ed Alliance Manager, Nancy, will be dropping that in the chat. So be sure to share your feedback with us. And of course, if you're like me, you're wishing that we could just spend the entire rest of the afternoon together. And if you are feeling that way, be sure to register for our next Meeting of the Minds. That's going to be on April 3rd. And Dean Pontelli is actually going to be leading that session for us. It's a session on AI in BPC work. So we're really excited and looking forward to that. So I hope you all will join us then. So thank you so much. And I think we'll stay on for a few more minutes for anyone who would like to keep the party going. But thank you all so much for joining us today. And we're looking forward to seeing you again on April 3rd.
Thank you.